South Bend, Indiana, Notre Dame University had begun its 129th academic year as the Fighting Irish opened its athletic calendar against the highly touted Northern Wildcats. Graduation had taken All-America Gary DiNardo, and the Irish would sorely miss quarterback Joe Theismann, all-time Notre Dame offense leader. Coach Ara Persigian had groomed a trio of talents at the signal caller slot. Number two, Bill Etter, was fully recovered from the recurring headaches that almost ended his football career. Pat Steenberg handed to 1970 leading rusher Ed Gulyas, and the Irish had its first TD 8 minutes into the new season. The Wildcats tied the score on their next series, but this 32-yard strike from Etter to halfback Bill Gallagher set up the second Irish touchdown. Then it was Steenberg giving to Bob Minix, leading Irish rusher for 1971. Touchdown, Notre Dame. Steenberg, a junior, was Theismann's understudy last year and had obviously picked up a few pointers from Jersey Joe, like how to set up a screen to Tom Gatewood. Tackles Jim Humbert and John Dampier, guards John Kondrick and Frank Pomerico, and center Dan Novikoff gave Steenberg time to find All-America Tom Gatewood for the third Irish touchdown. The veteran Irish defense opened the new season by allowing only 37 yards rushing. This interception by number 21, Ralph Stefaniak, was one of seven picked off by the Irish secondary. Stefaniak's 40-yard return gave Notre Dame a 36-7 advantage after three periods. By the fourth quarter, the Wildcats were scrambling to catch up, but Murray Denu's throw was picked off by safety Mike Crotty for a 65-yard touchdown return. The Irish whipped Big Ten co-favorite Northwestern 50-7. The offensive and defensive units functioned nearly to perfection, but the defense looked like the Irish strong suit. As long as it functioned well, the Irish would be everyone's team to beat. The Battle of the Bulls came only once, and General Custer never asked Sitting Bull for a rematch. But every year since 1946, the Irish and the Boilermakers have staged their own Saturday afternoon war. A steady rain helped to set the tenor of the late September contest. The Irish defense held Purdue at bay in their own territory. Notre Dame crushed the Boilermakers a year ago, 48-0. But Purdue was determined to avoid a whitewash in 71, and the game was scoreless near the end of the half. Then Gary Danielson made the slippery turf work for him as he combined with halfback Otis Armstrong for 26 yards to give Purdue a 7-0 lead, which was to hold up until the game's final 3 minutes. In the hard rain and waning sunlight of the fourth quarter, the defense did it again. Halfback Clarence Ellis blew Scott Lockheed away from the ball, and Fred Swenson fell on it for an Irish touchdown as his teammates lent moral support in the form of an impromptu rain dance. While near the sideline, players celebrated and Era plotted the winning play. And a Purdue coach contemplated disaster. It was the biggest play of the young season as Pat Steenberg faked Bill Gallagher into the line and hit tight end Mike Creaney all alone for 2 points to give the Irish an 8-7 victory over Purdue. And its first win at Ross-H Stadium since 1961. Notre Dame's third Big Ten opponent was Michigan State, featuring All-America running back Eric Allen. The defense had scored three of the eight Notre Dame touchdowns in 1971. Now the offense got to work. Bill Etter hit Bob Minix early in the first period. The Irish were determined to make it three in a row over the Spartans, who have managed only two victories in the last eight games between the two teams. Tom Gatewood attracts five Spartan tacklers as the blue and gold move toward pay dirt. Novikov, Kondrick, Dampier, and Creaney move the Spartan defense out as Bob Minix cracks over the end line to give the Irish a 7-0 lead. And then the Spartans open up. Quarterback Frank Colts rifles a strike to Billy Joe Dupree, who makes it look easy before Mike Crotty and Ralph Stepaniak stop him at the Notre Dame 6. But an official rules that Michigan State had proceeded illegally, and MSU's big play is nullified. The Spartans' offense couldn't generate a drive, and it was only seconds later that the defense once again set up an Irish score with this fumble recovery. Ed Gulyas's leg injury in the first game of the season had opened the lineup to reserve running back sophomore Greg Hill, number 22. Andy Huff, Bill Gallagher, and John Kondrick led the interference as Bob Minix scored the game's final TD. Michigan State picked up a safety on an Irish end zone fumble recovery, but it wasn't enough to keep Notre Dame from going 3-0 on the season. Mission Impossible was the story as the Miami Hurricanes hosted the Irish in the Orange Bowl. The Hurricanes were off to a great start under their new coach, Fran Searcy, and they offered lots of scrappy resistance. Fullback Andy Huff churns out a first down. The stubborn Hurricanes kept their end zone clean until sophomore place kicker Bob Thomas poked the ball through the uprights for a 3-0 halftime lead. While the defense held the Hurricanes to 111 yards total offense, the Irish ground corps was churning out 257 yards, averaging almost 5 yards per carry. Sophomore quarterback Cliff Brown gives this one to rushing leader Bob Minix for nine more. Perfect blocking up front is the key that unlocks Andy Huff's door to the end zone, and Darrell Dewan welcomes him in. Irish 10, Miami nothing. In the last quarter, Cliff Brown shows his style as he keeps for 33 yards to open another TD drive. Senior quarterback Bill Etter had suffered a knee injury in the first half and saw no more action in 1971. Brown picked up five more yards and Miami drew half the distance for sparing. The Irish running backs broke Miami's defenses time and time again. Darrell Dewan, number 10, ended Notre Dame scoring with this 6-yard run, and the fourth Irish victory of the season was a shutout, 17-0. Then it was back home to South Bend to open a 3-game homestand starting with North Carolina, Atlantic Coast Conference champion. Tar Heel statistics were good, better than Notre Dame. And Coach Persegian expected a tough game from Bill Dooley's experienced squad. Ed Gulyas was still recovering from a fractured tibia, and some of the slack was taken up by Bill Gallagher, who shows the trademark of a top-flight ball carrier, lowering the shoulder for additional yardage. Bob Thomas tied a Notre Dame record with three first-half field goals against the Tar Heels. The first was from 28 yards out. Cliff Brown stepped in as number one Irish signal caller and showed great presence for a sophomore and promise for improvement. Early in the second period, Thomas booted his second field goal from 27 yards out for a 6-0 lead. The Tar Heels returned the ensuing kickoff 58 yards, then went to work with their high-powered offense. But Paul Miller's left-handed pass was picked off by All-America Clarence Ellis to give the Irish good field position. The Gator Bowl-bound Tar Heels had opened their season with two shutouts over Richmond and Illinois, but found the Irish much harder to collar, especially the Brown to Gatewood combination. The offensive line did its job well every game, moving the defense out so that John Juszkowski could smash out a first down. But it was Bob Thomas who soccer kicked his way into the Irish record book with his third three-pointer of the first half. The Irish controlled the ball through most of the game, mounted a touchdown drive in the last quarter. Cliff Brown sets up a perfect screen pass to Daryl DeWan for a first down to the Tar Heel 29. John Juszkowski, number 35, picked up another behind great upfront blocking. The Irish had set North Carolina up by running on most crucial yardage plays. Now Brown sprung the trap and flipped to Gatewood deep in the end zone, giving Notre Dame a second straight shutout victory, 16-0. Notre Dame dominated all the game's vital statistics, doubling all the Tar Heel stats on that beautiful October day. But the next week would bring a major shift of Irish fortune. It was wet in South Bend and Southern Cal was in town, the team that beat the Irish in the Los Angeles downpour last year. The USC and Notre Dame game is always the highlight of the collegiate season. Coaches, players, and fans wait for a Notre Dame-USC contest like they wait for the heavyweight title fight. They're never disappointed. Number 8, Jimmy Jones, owns most of the Southern Cal record book space in the passing department. Clarence Ellis lost his footing on the wet grass and was forced to watch helplessly as Edsel Garrison scored the game's first point. Things looked better for the Irish on the ensuing kickoff when Gary Dimmock returned 66 yards up the left side. Larry Parker, number 26, led all Irish ground gainers against the Trojans. His 15-yard draw gives the Irish a first and goal. Southern Cal entered the game with a 2-4 record, but with an offense averaging 380 yards per game. The Irish are near the 300 mark, mostly because of their running backs. Daryl DeWan's goal line block puts Andy Huff across, and it's USC 7, Notre Dame 7. But a 65-yard kickoff return put the ball deep in Irish territory, and quarterback Mike Ray picked on Edsel Garrison again. The junior split end had two steps on Mike Crotty. USC added two more in the second period and led 28-7 at halftime. It was late in the third quarter when the Irish offense rumbled back to life. Cliff Brown got all the protection he needed before finding Mike Creaney 38 yards downfield. Then fullback John Juszkowski intimidated the Trojans' last defender and cracked over for the last Irish score. Although the Irish defense had kept Southern Cal out of its end zone in the second half, the Trojans held onto their lead to eliminate Notre Dame from the ranks of the unbeaten. The Navy sailed into South Bend on October 30th. The Middies haven't beaten the Irish since 1963 and lost 56-7 in Philadelphia last year. Notre Dame was not expected to be in a sympathetic mood coming off the previous week against USC. Notre Dame ignited its scoring fuse on its first series with Andy Huff breaking through for 17 yards. Execution is the key at Notre Dame. Watch Ed Gulyas follow three great blocks to pay dirt. Irish 7, Navy nothing. In the first half, the middies could pick up only 3 yards rushing, while Irish backs Minix, Parker, and Gulyas trampled out 211 yards on the ground. Gulyas, a 5'11", 190-pound senior, almost ran out of his pants as he added an 18-yard sprint for a first down. The Irish raised the ante once again as Bob Minix broke over center from the one to make it 14-0. Navy fumbled the ensuing kickoff, and Notre Dame recovered with great field position. It was Bob Minix who scored his second TD of the game from 10 yards out. The Irish defense recorded its third shutout of the season, and Tom Gatewood passed Jim Seymour's career yardage total to become the all-time Notre Dame reception leader as Navy went under 21-0.
Defense is tough mainly because of the people connected with it, I guess. What we try to do basically is find the quick guys that like to hit and react, and we'll pursue the ball. Walt Patulski, our captain, who plays a defensive end for us, he's 6'6", about 260. Walt has the range to come in and block a lot of passes. He also has the mobility to ward off the fullback block and the ends turnout block, and also at the same time recover to the outside and turn the run back in. Alongside of Walt is our tackle, Mike Kadish. Mike is about 6'4", about 265. Mike's job is a little different from Walt's. His basically is to neutralize the blocker or meet the blocker and then to come off the block and get into the pursuit and still maintain pressure on the passer. Most of the time, Mike's fighting two or three people in there. The other tackle, Greg Marks, as another 6'4", about 265, has range for the good pass rush, fights the double team, very similar to Mike Kadish and doing a fine job. At the other end, we have Fred Swenson, who's the smallest of the four. Fred is about 6'4", about 240. It has a lot of mobility, a lot of speed, a lot of quickness. We try to get Walt and Swede to squeeze them into Kadish and Marks, and then we kind of clean up with the linebackers and the three deep.
The Irish defense ranked fourth in the nation in 1971, behind the work of other standout performers like Mike Zekas, number 79. Linebacker Jim Mazurka, number 47, returns in 72. Number 45, senior Eric Patton, had 79 tackles. Rich Toman, number 38, a senior, will be sorely missed. Number 81, Jim O'Malley, with 72 tackles, a junior. Senior Ralph Stupaniak, number 21, had 3 interceptions. Mike Crotty, number 17, stands 5'9 in his bare feet. But with his cleats on, you'd never know it. His 65 tackles were just 9 behind Walt Patulski's total. Junior Ken Sleezes led the secondary with 4 interceptions. All-America Clarence Ellis, 3 interceptions, broke up passes time and again. Pitt Panther coach Carol DePasqua had called Notre Dame the strongest team his club played all year. The Panther opponents included Eastern Powers, Boston College, West Virginia, Syracuse, and Penn State, as well as Oklahoma and UCLA. A sellout crowd at Pitt Stadium watched the Irish score on their first series. Larry Parker scored twice in the first quarter, this one from 9 yards out as Ed Gulyas, number 12, threw a perfect block on the Panthers' strong safety. Minutes later, the Irish showed Pitt their version of the wishbone offense, with Cliff Brown directing the pitch to Parker, who shows great balance in his 15-yard run. Parker totaled 64 yards rushing in the first half, 24 more than the entire Panther team. This 6-yard burst gave Notre Dame a 14-0 lead. In the second quarter, Cliff Brown also outrushed the Panther team with this 47-yard sprint, the longest of the season from scrimmage. 254 of the 464 yards on the ground were tallied in the first half. Then it was Parker's turn to block for Gulyas. Touchdown. Ed added another TD plunge, and it was 28-7 at the half. The Notre Dame defense was second in the nation against the rush. Pitt added only 2 yards on the ground in the second half, and the blue and gold backs never let up. Even when the Panthers knew it was coming, the Irish line kept them from making the big play. Ed Gulyas chalked up TD number 3. Jim Mazurka recovered a Pitt fumble seconds later, and the turnover added more Irish points as Tom Gatewood found himself covered rather loosely in the end zone. Next to the defense, the biggest plus in 1971 was the strength of the reserves. Sophomore halfback Greg Hill led another assault on the Pitt end zone. And in one of the prettiest plays of the year, it was Steenberge to Hill to Willie Townsend to touchdown. The Irish had built a 49-7 lead with more to come. Nothing went the Panthers' way. Notre Dame's only punt of the second half became a score as Gary Demenick creamed the return man and Willie Townsend recovered. Seconds later, Darryl Dewan powered in behind Bill Gallagher and Greg Hill as the Irish recorded a 56-7 thrashing of Pitt, upping the season slate to 7-1. Then the Irish returned home to face the green wave of Tulane, victors over both Pitt and North Carolina. Tulane moved quickly on the arm of Rusty Lachusey to flanker Steve Berrios, and Tulane had a 7-0 lead at halftime. But things began to happen in the second half. The offense may have found inspiration in the fact that the defense had not allowed any second-half scoring all season. Whatever it was, Larry Parker had it. He shook off 2 tackles and got mad at himself for stepping out. Cliff Brown scored his first Irish touchdown to even up the game. Still in the third quarter, John Chiskowski pulled and battered the Green Wave defense for 17 yards. With 3rd down and 3, Brown elected to try the airways. Gatewood made a beautiful falling catch for the first down. This was the last home game for 11 seniors starting for the Irish, but it was sophomore Brown to junior Mike Creaney for the second Irish score of the afternoon. Center Dan Novikoff will be the only interior lineman to graduate this year. Irish opponents in 72 will find it very hard to defend against Casper, Bomarico, Kondrick, and Dampier. Larry Barker's longest rush of the afternoon was this 15-yard draw to set up the final Notre Dame touchdown. Then, from the five, Cliff Brown scored his second of the afternoon. The Irish log read 8-1 as they washed past the green wave 21-7. A national TV audience was on hand as the Irish invaded Baton Rouge to meet the Bayou Bengals of LSU on November 20th. The Tigers were out for blood, remembering 1970's 3-0 loss to the Irish. They scored first on a 36-yard strike. Brown moved the Irish in the second period. This reverse to Willie Townsend added another 34 yards. The many spectacular plays of the game occurred here. Brown lifts a pass to Parker, and linebacker Lloyd Fry barely breaks it up in the end zone. Then, after intercepting a Cliff Brown pass, Tiger quarterback Burt Jones lofted another big one to slot back Andy Hamilton, who shot past Mike Crotty. The score at the half was LSU 14, Notre Dame nothing. LSU added another score in the third period after a fumble recovery. But the fourth quarter saw the Irish playing a good game of catch-up football. Another dramatic moment unfolded early in the final period as Tiger All-America safety Tommy Casanova robbed the Irish of another TD. Minutes later, the Irish drove again with Brown targeting the graduation-bound Gatewood, who etched his name deeper into the Notre Dame record book with each clutch reception. It was Gatewood outleaping Casanova to put Notre Dame on the scoreboard. The Irish finished the season with an 8-2 record and look forward to new challenges in 1972. Returning veterans for next year include on offense Cliff Brown, Mike Creaney, Larry Parker, Andy Huff, Darryl DeWan, John Chiskowski, and linemen Dave Casper, John Dampier, John Kondrick, Frank Pomerico, and Willie Townsend. Defense returnees include Greg Marks, Jim Mazurka, Jim O'Malley, and Ken Schlesis. Join us again next September for another great season of Notre Dame football.